It's my pleasure to serve as the moderator. And my name is Dave Bouchard. I'm the CEO of the San Carlos Chamber of Commerce. The program this evening is hosted by the San Carlos Chamber, a 600-member association of local businesses and individuals organized to ensure a vital local economy. Our purpose this evening is to provide a forum for candidates for the position of San Carlos City Council to address some of the principal issues that will shape the direction and quality of life in our community. I want to welcome those who are present with us in the City Council chambers this evening, and those who are watching this program on Millbrae Community Television. Millbrae TV will, as a community service, rebroadcast this program several times before the election on Comcast Channels 27 and AT&T Channel 99. Before we begin, let me tell you about the format for the candidates forum this evening. In a few minutes, we'll begin the meeting. We'll begin meeting the five candidates for City Council. This discussion is scheduled for about 90 minutes. All discussion this evening will be in response to questions developed by a committee of the San Carlos Chamber of Commerce, as well as written questions from our audience this evening, and we'll get to as many of those as we can. For those in attendance, if you would like to submit a question, and many of you already have received the form, just ask Tom. David's in the back of the room there. I will read the questions and ask each candidate to respond to every question. We'll limit response time to 90 seconds for each candidate. I know it sounds like a brief response, but this will allow us to discuss a number of important issues this evening. To help the candidates stay on their time limit, Jason Mansfield, a Chamber board member, will serve as timekeeper. He will signal each candidate when the 90-second time limit has been reached, and I'll ask each candidate to please respond to the time limits. I have two requests for the audience. Number one, please turn off your cell phones again. And number two, since this is an educational forum and not a partisan political event, I would like to ask you to please refrain from any show of support for or opposition to any of the candidates or their remarks this evening. In other words, no cheering, no booing or applause, and no political statements from the floor. Thank you very much for adhering to those basic rules for this evening's forum. I want to begin by expressing appreciation on behalf of the entire San Carlos community to each of the five candidates that we'll be meeting this evening. Our thanks to each of you for caring enough about the community to run for City Council. Becoming a candidate and serving on the City Council represents one of the highest expressions of service to this community, and we applaud that. We have five candidates for three seats on the City Council. Each candidate is seeking a four-year term on the council. I ask the audience to please remain silent and withhold your applause either before or after the questioning. The candidates from your left to right are Ken Castle, John McDowell, Sarah McDowell, Laura Palmer-Lohan, and Adam Rack. I'll ask each of the candidates to please take 2 minutes to tell us about yourself and why you are running for City Council. And we'll begin with Ken.
Thank you, David. Welcome everyone to this event. I'm pleased that you're able to take a little time off and come out and listen to us and hopefully contribute some ideas. The first thing I'd like to do is commend the outgoing City Council members for their years of service to the city. As you know, the position is largely voluntary and definitely has its ups and downs. I believe the current council members have listened to the community, used their best judgment when voting on critical issues. I've worked with most of the members on one project or another over the years and come to know them as forthright, meticulous, and honorable individuals. So now this election is about moving forward and perhaps facing the greatest opportunities and challenges in the history of San Carlos. My wife and I have lived here for over 10 years now, and during most of that time, I've worked to improve our neighborhood safety in White Oaks, where I live. I established a neighborhood watch program that actually ended up having about 40 block captains throughout the region. With cooperation from the police, sheriff's department, and the public works department, we've managed to collaborate and have a big impact on reducing crime in our neighborhood. So I'm really someone who likes to take a minute to look at the problem and find a solution. What my neighbors know about me is that when I do see a problem, I don't hesitate to look for an answer or a solution. So now I'd like to extend that problem-solving approach to the rest of the city. I come to voters with a long record of involvement with all levels of government. I spent years as a newspaper journalist and never was afraid to ask questions. I learned the ins and outs of local, state, and regional government. Most recently, I've spent about 15 years working at technology companies in Silicon Valley, so I have quite a background in that. I'd like to do a lot more engaging in the regional solutions that face us. And at the same time, it's clear to me that in addition to a lot of the regional problems, many residents want a smart growth plan that protects the small town feeling of our city. I've seen what works and what doesn't. And I believe that this outside perspective would broaden the quality and leadership of our city council. Thank you.
Well, thanks, David, and thanks to the chamber for organizing the forum and for hosting, and for the city for hosting here in City Hall. And just like Ken, I want to thank all the other candidates here on the panel as well. He's right. It takes a lot of hard work and love for our city to take on the challenge of running for city council. So thanks to each of you. And I do want to say up front, yes, there are two McDowells sitting next to each other, and we're not at all related, and it is a coincidence. It truly is. But I also want to thank all of you here in the room and those watching online. You know, we're lucky as a town to have so many, and look how full this room is, who care about the future of our city and how together we can make it better. And this election is all about the future, about the kind of town we want San Carlos to be and how we can make that happen. When I'm talking to residents, I find that many of us are concerned that although we moved here for small town charm in the middle of an urban area, we're rapidly losing that charm to the development we see all around us and with more development to come. So I'm specifically running to slow, unchecked development. We simply have too much too soon. Instead, I'll work with our council colleagues, including those here on the panel, to make sure that any new development that we have is in character with the rest of our city, that we review and strengthen mitigation and fees we require from developers to make sure they bear their fair share of the development burden, and that we ensure that our resources, our roads, our parks, our schools, and our water are not overwhelmed. I'm running to keep the character of San Carlos so that as we move into the future, we have the kind of town that we all enjoy now as well. And I ask all of you to join me in making that future the best it can be. Thanks.
Thank you to the chamber and to all of you here tonight for the opportunity to speak about the issues that are so important to our community. San Carlos is a very special place to me and my family. It's the place where my father-in-law grew up and attended San Carlos High. It's the place where my husband and I have decided to raise our two children. And it's a place I've been deeply committed to serving. Since moving here in 2010, I've led PTA fundraising at Britton Acres School for 3 years. I sat on the San Carlos Education Foundation Board for 2 years. I currently serve on the Parks and Rec Foundation, and I'm also serving as a commissioner for the San Carlos Economic Development Advisory Commission. As a commissioner, I've had a bird's eye view into how our city works and the issues that need to be tackled. In the coming years, our city council will need to balance preserving the characteristics that make our town so unique with taking an active role in managing future growth and development. If elected, I will drive a hard bargain with developers to ensure that projects meet needs specific to San Carlos and that these projects have a positive impact on our community. I will advocate for improving our streets and sidewalks, increasing access to public parking, reducing traffic congestion, building more affordable housing units, and funding community benefits like parks. I have what it takes to be a successful member of our city council. My career in the federal government working on international trade policy has given me the tools to effectively navigate bureaucracy and advocate for our community. I want to ensure that the decisions our city leaders are making will not only address the issues facing our community now, but also where we need to be 20 years from now. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Laura Palmer Lohan, and I am privileged and honored to be running for San Carlos City Council. I want to thank the Chamber of Commerce tonight, Dave Bouchard and Jason, for your contribution this evening, and Tom Davids for helping us get into the room safely. This journey started quite unexpectedly for me a couple of years ago. We moved to San Carlos for the schools, and we were thrilled with what we found. My boys are thriving, and in fact, they're both taller than me and eat more than I do. My son came to me after the presidential election, and he told me that he was very upset with the way that people were treating each other. And in that moment, it gave me pause, because I realized I hadn't left the place better than I had found it. And I did an immediate reflection upon all the amazing things that we have going for us. One is that we live in San Carlos, and a lot of people want to live here. It does have that amazing, unique personality, but what's really amazing to me about San Carlos is not just its charm, but the people. I've never lived in a community, and I've lived all over California, where there is such a strength in community. The fact that you are all here tonight in these chambers wanting to hear who your next council members and representatives will be just shows me how much everybody cares about this community. In addition, those people who are watching at home and the people who've helped me on this journey. Most importantly, I want to thank my family because it was a family decision. And I decided to do this not only for my family, but for my larger family, my family in San Carlos. I've talked to hundreds of you when I've been out canvassing. I've talked to elected leaders, and we're all facing similar challenges that are not brought onto us by our own choosing. We happen to live in the heart of Silicon Valley, the largest economic growth engine that the world has probably ever seen, and it's not going to slow down anytime soon. But what we don't have is a common vision for all of the development that's happening in San Carlos. We have a beautiful general plan, but it's not clearly defined. And I want the conversations that I've had with all of you over gallons of coffee, and I love coffee, believe me, I want to continue those conversations and make myself accessible so that we can create that common vision for San Carlos.
First, let me thank the Chamber for hosting tonight's forum, and thanks to all of you for coming and listening to this discussion on issues important to our town. I moved to amazing San Carlos 17 years ago to plant roots and raise a family with my wife, Allison, who is a native San Carlin. This has and continues to be a vibrant, dynamic community that I am proud to call home. All my life, I've embraced community service, and it's a central tenet to how we raise our daughters. Coaching youth sports, volunteering in the classroom, and serving on the San Carlos Chamber of Commerce Board are all ways I've immersed myself here. Most relevantly, I had the honor of being elected to the school board by the people of San Carlos. San Carlos is in the midst of significant change, and it is causing challenges for us. We are facing growing pains. Yes, we must address these issues, but we also need to take advantage of these prosperous times to bring more amenities into our community and to prepare for potential shifts in our economic future. We must be prudent with public dollars and purposeful in our actions. I have the experience to do just that. I've spent my entire career, over 25 years, in and around government at all levels, working on Capitol Hill, advocating at the state level, and working hand in hand with local constituents as a school board trustee. We are a fantastic town, and I have truly enjoyed this campaign, meeting so many St. Carlins who are interested and engaged in this community, whether it's over coffee at Hometown Days, St. Carlos Day of Service, knocking on doors, or just stopping and talking to someone while I'm walking on the street. We are diverse and engaged. Our views may differ, but we need to listen, talk, and work together to help make positive change happen. I'm humbled to be endorsed by over 250 St. Carlins who are community and business leaders, including 9 St. Carlos mayors, 10 school board trustees, and 11 citizens of the year. I'm committed to working to make a difference in St. Carlos, to tackle our challenges head on with a focus on improving our quality of life and making our wonderful community even better. I look forward to your support.
Well, thank you very much for those opening statements. And now on to the prepared questions. The first question, we'll begin with Ken and work from left to right. How do you envision San Carlos changing and evolving over the next 10 to 20 years? Ken.
Well, clearly, I don't think anybody sitting in this room 10 years ago envisioned that the values of residential and commercial property would go through the roof the way they've done. We know that city demographics are transitioning. More and more young families are moving in with technology and professional backgrounds. We have a lot of leaders in various industries. Basically, they want larger living spaces to accommodate growing families. That's put a strain on many neighborhoods. They want a vibrant downtown with top quality restaurants and shops. They want the best schools in the region. And above all, they want a safe and secure place to raise their children. We need to manage this evolution. We also need to provide reliable revenue sources to operate our city government. What we're likely going to see are more pressures for high-rise, high-density buildings. But if we don't provide more affordable housing, then we'll lose the employees that keep the city's economic engines running. We need to look at these projects very carefully, whether it's apartments, condominiums, more homes, and make the best choices. We know that we have finite land for new construction, and we have to choose the projects and sites with great care. We may need to make some changes in the zoning and the master plan if we're to meet key state, regional, and local mandates for affordable housing. If I'm elected, I will definitely take a very hard look at everything that comes to the city. Thank you.
John, same question.
Okay, thanks, David. You know, there's no question that San Carlos will change in the coming decades, just as it has in the past decades. It certainly changed a lot from when I went to Britton Acres, when I went to Terralunda, and the late lamented San Carlos High. The question is, though, what kind of change will it be, and how can we shape that change to reflect the character and value of our town? You know, some changes, as Ken mentioned, will be driven by new technologies that are just coming online. Autonomous vehicles will probably change the way that we drive and the way that we park and those kinds of patterns. And other new technologies will do the same. And it's clear we'll have new development, but we need to ensure that development fits with our town and doesn't overwhelm it. What I don't see changing are those things that define the character of our town and always have. You know, I see a safe town where children can freely ride their bikes or whatever replaces them to school. I see a town that values and honors our seniors with programs that support them as they age in place. And I see a walkable, friendly town where an evening stroll in Laurel means running into neighbors and friends. And most importantly, I see a town infused with the volunteer spirit we have today that this room really exemplifies. What makes us special are the myriad ways that everyone here comes together to build a community, and I don't see that changing at all. Thanks.
Sarah?
San Carlos and neighboring cities are facing a period of unprecedented growth. I want to take a pragmatic approach to ensure public safety resources are protected, development projects include benefits that positively impact San Carlos, and parking and traffic concerns are addressed. San Carlos must budget and proactively plan now in order to meet the increased demand for services that our community will require in the coming years as a result of the growth occurring now. I also want to ensure that as our community grows, the characteristics that make San Carlos so unique are preserved. We are fortunate to live in a town that is safe, that has a thriving downtown business district, and that has a beautiful parks and rec program that we all enjoy. I don't want any of that to change. I will work hard to preserve the characteristics that make San Carlos the city of good living. Nevertheless, we all recognize that the secret is out about San Carlos among developers. This is a prime location to build. If elected, I will take an active role in managing development to make sure that as a city, we are making smart and responsible land use decisions. I will drive a hard bargain with developers to ensure that projects meet needs specific to San Carlos. I will advocate for improving our streets and sidewalks around development projects, increasing access to public parking, building more affordable housing units, and funding community benefits like parks. Thank you.
Laura?
Thank you, Dave. So I think I would rather change the way the question is asked, because in my mind, it's not what I envision for our city, but it's what our city envisions for itself. As I talked about earlier in my opening statement, what I am so amazed about with San Carlos is just the incredible involvement of the community. Every weekend, there's some activity that we can all participate in. We don't have to leave our 6 square miles to go meet with our friends and neighbors. That being said, and I talked about this earlier, we do have a general plan, but that general plan is not in complete focus in my mind. So what I see on the east side, which is really at the spear of the development right now and undergoing tremendous stress with the traffic and congestion, lack of parking, and all the construction projects, is a mix of building that is not clear to me what we're doing. We're putting in 2 million square feet of office space that will go to a high-tech or biotech organization. I've sat with the developers and I've talked to them about the number of parking spots versus the number of employees, and I'm not particularly satisfied with the answers. In addition, I asked them if they could potentially build out daycare center there, because we have a lack of shortage, 15,000 infants in San Mateo County and only 1,000 spots. And she told me it was too late. So as a working mom, as a small business owner, and somebody who hires people to work in my business in San Carlos, with my other half who raises money for the school foundation, we are deeply invested in this community. And I want that conversation to be a conversation of what we want for this town and what we want to build and how it's going to serve our teachers and first responders and the rest of the community.
Adam?
Always fun to go last on these kind of things. You feel like what hasn't been said yet, but I mean, I think it's clear that, you know, San Carlos is changing. We're going through a lot right now, and maybe more at once than we ever have before. As I mentioned, my wife grew up here, my mother-in-law grew up here, so I hear sort of some of the changes, and I've been here for 17 years, so I've seen that as well. But I think we can take that change in a positive way, and I think we can proactively shape that to our benefit. Certainly, we need to be mindful of the infrastructure that's there. We can't, we have to deal with parking and traffic. We have to deal with some of the other areas like daycare that was talked about, or aftercare. We have to make sure we can find housing for our teachers, and we can hire, that restaurants aren't suffering and not being able to hire waiters and other workers, that healthcare workers can afford to live here. So we need to invest in our community, improve our quality of life, and I think we do need to work with the developers to get more from them, to make sure it's coming back into our community. We do a lot of these coffees and events, and one of them, a person said to me, when you start to have a couple developers walk away, then you know you're asking enough from them. And I think we need to start thinking about that. Are we getting enough for our community from the people who want to exact those changes? But I also think we need to look at building parks. We talk, the east side is a good opportunity to do that, to get Pulgas Creek cleaned up and create a greenway and add more more green space for our community. So I think we have to be creative about solving some of the solutions. But I'm sort of a glass half full person. I think that over time, if we work together as a community, we can enact positive change.
Thank you. Second question is a two-parter, and we'll start with John. Where and how much and what kind of housing would you like to see developed in San Carlos? And secondly, how would you address the state requirements for the city to provide its fair share of housing so that funding and services to the city are not at risk?
All right, thanks, Dave. Well, housing is clearly an important issue. We've already heard here on the panel, not only here, but across the county. And I think it's probably on the minds of everyone sitting in this room right now. You know, currently, the city has met the housing requirements imposed on us by the state. Some of you may not know, but the state government requires that cities zone for a certain amount of housing to be built across a range of affordable areas. And that right now in San Carlos, we don't have a jobs housing imbalance, but regionally we do. And the new laws are now requiring cities, as kind of mentioned in the question here, to actually build those units or risk funding for vital services. And over time, San Carlos right now has been building those units. So my view is that for new units that we do permit and build, that they, of course, fit with the character of the neighborhood they're in, and we don't get steamrolled by developers who demand that bigger is better. Although large, the new Transit Village is actually 2 stories lower than developers first proposed, while claiming that any reduction in size wouldn't be financially feasible. But Greater Eastside San Carlos made itself heard, and citizens organized and pushed back, and the result is a much less massive and intrusive development. And we should give every development that kind of scrutiny. The new development we need are the developments that feature affordable housing, and particularly I want to focus on workforce housing. That's an issue with our teachers. We have a real issue there, an issue with our city employees as well. So one of the things I want to work on is work with other jurisdictions in the area to develop workforce housing, not only for San Carlos, but for other areas as well, possibly in some county-owned property.
Sarah?
Thanks, Dave. City government manages and guides development, and I would take that job very seriously. I would like to see the city work cooperatively with developers and nonprofits to build a variety of housing that is needed in our community, condos and apartments, rentals and units for sale, market rate and affordable housing units. I support development of transit-oriented housing in San Carlos. I also recognize that apartment buildings built near the Caltrain corridor can impact our East Side community. The city must be thoughtful about development and engage in outreach and discussion with our community when considering projects along the transit corridor and work hard to find solutions that address concerns of neighborhoods adjacent to these projects. Recent large developments in San Carlos and neighboring communities have not been required to build enough affordable housing. I want to change San Carlos's policy of accepting in-lieu fees from developers. If elected, I will advocate for a policy that requires developers to build a percentage of affordable housing units instead of accepting payments into an in-lieu fund. I believe our community is better served when people can afford to live in the towns in which they work. Thank you.
Laura?
Thank you. So the issue has come up several times around affordable housing in San Carlos, and I think it's critical that we think about this. It's a crisis that we're facing in California and in San Mateo County alone. In the last, since 2010, 75,000 jobs have been created, but a small fraction of housing units for that. In fact, I spoke to my child's science teacher recently, and I asked her how she was doing. She's a middle school teacher. She said she's been in the district for 7 years, but she doesn't think she can stay. Her rent went up 10%, and she's currently living with her sister and her sister's boyfriend, and they're about to buy a house. Her salary only went up 1.5%. I was speaking to a woman when I was out canvassing last weekend whose daughter wants to become a teacher but doesn't think that she can come back to San Carlos. My son's high school coach luckily lives in the community within which he served, and he talked to me about the power of having that presence locally. So I think that we need to do everything that we can. Currently, San Carlos, as I mentioned, is 6 square miles. It's teeny, and every plot of land has already been built on. So we can look at redevelopment and infill, and I believe that it does need to be along public transportation corridors. In addition, I think we need to come up with other creative solutions. So for example, if we can increase childcare capacity and lower that outlay for the residents, then they can cover some of the savings, for example, with their mortgage. We could look at low interest loans, et cetera, for civil servants and teachers and first responders so that they can afford their home. I think it's going to take creative and innovative solutions and a portfolio of solutions to tackle the housing crisis. Auxiliary dwelling units are something that I learned about when I was on the Single Family Housing Advisory Committee, that we can create. If 10% of homeowners in the Bay Area did that, we would be able to solve the housing crisis.
Adam?
Thank you. I have to keep remembering to turn this thing on and off. I'm afraid I'm going to leave it on or something. Clearly we have, as others have mentioned, we have a housing crisis here, and particularly I think an affordable housing crisis. We have a diverse community of people living in San Carlos who have been here for a long time, and it's part of what makes us and is part of the strength of our community. And we have to, it's important that we kind of let people and provide the opportunity for people to stay here. We do meet our overall housing allowance and requirements. What we don't do is on the affordable housing side. But there are changes in the state law that I think can help us make a difference that allows us for apartment buildings now to require affordable units being built instead of in-lieu fees. And so that's something the city needs to change, and I totally support that. I think that's the better approach to trying to address some of the affordable housing that we have. I don't think the city needs to be the one driving, building the units. We've got developers who will do it, and they're much better at doing that. But requiring them to put units in there is the better approach than in-lieu fees. And I do think that looking at transit-oriented housing and more denser housing over long transit is a good way to go.
And Ken.
So I've worked with a company that's had quite a lot of experience in both transit villages and affordable housing projects, particularly in San Francisco. We need to take a page from that city. They've struggled through various processes, including their own housing authority, which didn't work out too well. But here's what they've come up with. There are a number of nonprofit community organizations. One of them is called the Chinatown Community Development Organization. They have something like 30 different properties. They collaborate with the city, and they collaborate with specific developers that are oriented to building affordable housing. What's not working in San Francisco is the mixed housing situation in which developers are being told they need to set aside 20% of a project. What happens is that makes the project unfeasible, and the long delays in getting it off the ground and building it have resulted in entire projects being abandoned in mid-construction. So we don't want to see that happen. We also need to reach out to other stakeholders, including school districts and the county, to look at opportunities to provide new sites and provide specific projects. This has to be a regional solution, not just San Carlos.
Okay, thank you all. On to question number three, this time we'll start with Sarah. What is your position on California State Proposition 10?
I believe the issues surrounding housing are caused by a lack of supply and a lack of prioritizing the development of affordable housing. The city of San Carlos needs to take a greater role in encouraging the development of affordable housing, including working with partner agencies to create more opportunities for affordable housing development. Our housing crisis is the result of an imbalance between housing supply and demand. Rent control will not solve the housing crisis. The repeal of Costa-Hawkins will open rent control to a wider range of housing, including single-family homes. This change has the potential to financially hurt many families who rely on rental properties as income. Most single-family home rentals in San Carlos are owned by families or in small portfolios. They are not typically owned by large corporations or housing developers. Capping the ability of these families to capture the full value of these rental properties is not something that I support.
Thank you. Proposition 10 in my mind is really about the issue that we're seeing going back to the school teacher that I mentioned whose rent went up 10% but her salary only 1.5%. What it has to do with is rent stabilization, and I agree that the only way for us to address it is to increase housing stocks for the workforce. There are a number of creative solutions I think that we can look to from other communities to address this. I think Proposition 10 would inhibit people's ability to rent out property to renters, and I think it's just simply not a good idea. As I mentioned, I think that we need to look at a number of other creative and innovative solutions to address the housing crisis.
Adam?
So I also think that Prop 10 isn't the right approach to addressing the housing crisis. It's a matter of supply and demand. We don't have enough housing units, particularly not enough affordable housing units. And by repealing Costa-Hawkins, we would allow rent control on, or the cities to put rent control on new developments. So it's going to have a chilling effect in terms of the growth that we need to happen. And on single-family housing stock, I've talked to someone who in town who owns a couple single-family houses, and she said she'd probably take them off the market and sell them because it would impact her ability to improve on those units and maybe keep them stable. And I think also just touching on the issue of rent control is not means tested. I mean, any one of us in here could be in a rent-controlled room, house, whether we need it or not. It's focusing on affordable housing and the people that need it to be part of this infrastructure and can live in this community who can't afford to live here. And that's really where we should focus on the affordable housing issue and trying to build more affordable housing units.
Ken?
Thanks. You know, I have a personal story that I'd like to share with you. Years ago, I inherited a small condominium from my grandmother who passed away. And we decided to rent it out. And in the course of 30 years, it's had all of three renters, all of three tenants. The latest tenant has been there close to 20 years, well below market rate rent. Basically, we want to just kind of meet the rent and any basic repairs or maintenance. Well, the city that this condo is located in has passed a rent control measure that prohibits us from increasing the rent more than 5% a year unless we go to an independent rent control hearing board with the tenant and make our case for what we should be doing. The problem is that we want to do some improvements. We want to do quite a number of improvements, but we can't finance them under the current rent. So we have two choices. We continue to manage the property the way it is without making anything more than basic repairs, or we sell the property, in which case our tenant, who is a single mother and has an aging father living with her, has to move somewhere else. Now, is that solving the problem, or is that creating more problems with Proposition 10? Definitely against.
John.
Now I feel like Adam, because I agree with everything that's been said here on this panel. I don't know what else I can add. I can say that I think the result of rent control will be less rental housing. That's been proven through research. People take units off the market. And of course, as Ken alluded to, deterioration in the condition of some rental housing units as well. You know, when both candidates for governor, Gavin Newsom and John Cox, opposed Proposition 10, you know it's a bad idea. I think so too.
Okay, thank you. And question four, this time we will begin with Laura. Since 2010, nearly 73,000 jobs have been created in San Mateo County, yet less than 4,500 housing units have been built. This is a ratio of approximately 15 jobs for every one unit of housing and partially explains why rents and housing prices are so high. If you were a member of the council, what role would you advocate that the city of San Carlos play in helping the county address this jobs housing imbalance?
Yeah, it's a great question. And as I've mentioned before, I think it's gonna be a portfolio solution approach that we take. Luckily, my candidacy has been supported by multiple elected officials from as far away as San Jose, all the way to people who traverse the halls of Sacramento. So I think it's important that the benefit of them endorsing me is the opportunity for me to reach out to them and ask for help to help us solve this. In addition to having developers set aside some below market rate units, which I think is important. A call, for example, building other types of styles of homes besides apartments would be called for. For example, I talked to a number of seniors who are empty nesters and they want to downsize, but there's nowhere for them to go. So I think we also need to look at the mix of housing. We have a two-car garage on our property that would be, it's a nice storage unit and a poorly used workout facility. And I can envision at some point in the future, if we were to build that out, one of my sons, or they could fight over the house that we have, and then I could live in the back and annoy them for the rest of their lives. But I think it's going to be, again, a mix of public-private partnerships and working with a number of organizations that are trying to solve this, and I'm prepared and I have the connections to the community to do that.
Adam?
So I agree we have an imbalance of, you know, new job growth and new housing growth. The numbers show that. And I think agree with Laura that we have to work, you know, more widely than just San Carlos to solve some of these solutions. It has to be a regional solution. We have to engage with Sacramento, with the county to do that. And I also think while people commute in, that people sometimes commute in for reasons. Some people want to live in San Francisco. Some people want to live by the coast or have more space than our community. So there's a certain amount of people who are going to commute in regardless of what we do. But, you know, look, I think for me and for others, it's good for the quality of life to live and work in the community, in the same community, to raise your family there and enjoy those benefits of the community. So I do think that we have to be responsible for creating a range of living options for people alongside the job growth in this community. And I think we also need to work on transit as well as part of this solution, because we need more public transportation. We need to get people to jobs in a way to get cars off the road, whether it's improving and encouraging more biking, whether it's public transportation, working with large employers to make sure that they are either subsidizing public transit or making sure that they're getting their employees that last mile from the train station to the jobs. But it has to be a group effort and a community effort with businesses and government together working to solve this solution, this problem.
Ken?
So I've been working diligently with transit agencies throughout the Bay Area. I've seen every single project that's come up that is noted as a transit village. And most of the early projects were generally market rate or above market rate, because it was considered that, especially in the South Bay, that well-paid technology workers would love to live next to a train station or BART or whatever, and be able to get into work without driving. In point of fact, these projects have not created the level of affordable housing, and even if there are some percentage set-asides, it's not enough. And in my view, almost all these transit villages and new projects going forward should all be directed to affordability and to well below market rate, and that the city here should participate with the nonprofit organizations that are in San Mateo County. One is called the Housing Leadership Council. We also have a Northern California affordable housing organization that recently held its conference. I think we need to work with those groups because they involve all the stakeholders, not just a few. And so we need that regional approach, and we need to institute it here. Thanks.
John?
So again, agreeing with many people here on the panel, I think that workforce housing is something the city needs to work on in particular. I think joining together with other jurisdictions across the county and looking for land somewhere here in the county, particularly maybe the county land up by the juvenile hall, where we can build workforce housing for multiple jurisdictions is one thing we can do. Secondly, I do agree with Sarah that with the new laws here, we are able to increase the percent of affordable units required in new rental development. And Ken is right, there can be an issue with financing, but we have to strike that balance, and I think we haven't quite done that yet. We can ask for more. And of course, more in-law units, I think, in San Carlos as well would work. Right now, it's about a 100-yard offset between where you can have in-law units, and we can maybe close that down once you can be closer together. But more importantly, I think we've been talking about supply of housing here. I think we need to address the demand. Everything we talk about here is, you know, oh, well, we've got a really high demand, and that really is the issue, okay? There's no silver bullet solutions on the supply side, because the marginal increases really won't help with ever-increasing demand. For a sustainable future, we need to focus on demand. You know, Palo Alto has realized that it's the building of offices that is increasing the rents there in their town. They just slashed the allowable development of office space in that town in half. Okay, and we need to think about that as well, because every new building that goes up is bringing people in from outside. We have 2% unemployment in this county. And every new building that goes up is bringing in people from the outside. They're either commuting in or they're trying to buy here. And the issue is that we have demand that we need to focus on slowing down.
And Sarah.
The lack of an adequate supply of housing is a challenge that is faced in San Carlos and in our region as a whole, and it is not something that our city can afford to ignore. When people who give so much to our community, our teachers, our first responders, our service industry workers, our plumbers and electricians, when they can't afford to live in our community, it's our loss in many ways. And it goes without saying that when employees live so far away from their jobs, their commutes are long and traffic congestion worsens. Affordable housing is an issue that's very important to me. I was raised by a single mom school teacher, and we were very fortunate to be able to live in the community where my mom worked. But today, that isn't the case for many of our educators here in San Carlos. My father-in-law is a retired Menlo Park fire captain, and he frequently tells me that his generation was the last that could afford to buy a house in Redwood City. The housing imbalance is a regional challenge, but San Carlos can do more to address this issue. The city can find creative ways to partner with developers and nonprofits to redevelop underused properties into new housing. Our affordable housing waitlist has ballooned to more than 900 households. The need is great, and this is an issue that we need to tackle going forward.
Okay, thank you. Next question, we'll begin with Adam. If I can bring it up here. Some have advocated for a moratorium on new commercial development in San Carlos. What are your thoughts?
Thank you. I'm glad I get to finally go first. Hopefully, say some new things that haven't been said already. You know, as I mentioned earlier, we are in the midst of some unprecedented growth and prosperity in our community, and we need to take advantage of that opportunity. We have a chance to generate more tax revenue for our community, to put more amenities into our community, to put money away for rainy day fund, because if we have some economic downturns, we are prepared to be in great fiscal shape in St. Carlos, and putting a moratorium on commercial growth to me is just the wrong way we should go. We need to continue to let our community grow and be an economic engine. That doesn't mean we have to just grow like crazy and not put some limits on things and not think about the impacts of that growth, but throwing everything into one corner is not the answer to do that. We have to work out our infrastructure. So, you know, we've had to deal with sewer lately. Is it going to be water? Is it going to be electrical? What are the other issues we're going to have to deal with our infrastructure? And if we're not generating that commercial revenue and tax revenue to help put back into the community, it's going to be on our backs to do that. And we need to work to, I think, continue to grow and look at opportunities. We have potential opportunities on the east side to make it a more vibrant, even more vibrant community, adding restaurants and retail as there's more commercial growth there. In South Laurel, to offer people in White Oaks more restaurants and retail to walk right there instead of everyone going to the 600 to 800 block. There is great potential in this community. We don't have to build like crazy, but we have great opportunity.
Ken?
You know, a lot of concern has been expressed to me by residents I've spoken with, not hundreds, but maybe dozens, that the pace of development is too fast and too big to absorb. And nothing underscores that point more than looking out the window and seeing what's happened to our railroad station. No one that I have talked to really can understand why the apartments and the office buildings are so close to the point where they're squeezing what used to be a nice place to go and have breakfast, as we know. With the Depot Cafe. We could have had more, perhaps 30 more feet on either side. We could have had some parking, but no, we didn't. We let the developers build right up to the edge of that historic building. You know, I lived in Burlingame for 18 years, and we had a 100-year anniversary of our main railroad station. We have two railroad stations there, and there was great respect by everybody in town, the Historical Society, the City Council, everyone, to not impose or impinge on those historic stations. That was a big mistake. That's something we shouldn't do again. The second thing I hear about is Wheeler Plaza. A lot of people are concerned about the height of that building. I'd say we need to be a little patient because the architectural design looks pretty good, and it might well fit in with our downtown area, but we do need to look very carefully at each project that comes along to see that it does fit with the character of our town and preserve that. I spent a lot of time in Burlingame fighting the changeover that could have resulted in high rises and other things downtown. So I've been down that road 20 years ago. We are 20 years behind the times here.
John?
So I absolutely agree that we should seek a temporary moratorium to study the issue of commercial development here in San Carlos so that our resources are not overwhelmed. And it can be done. Los Gatos has done it. And as I mentioned, Palo Alto just cut its future allowable office space development in half. Cities across the peninsula, even including now Redwood City, are recognizing that it's the commercial developments that's driving the problems we see around us. The traffic congestion, pressure on rents and housing prices, expanding population, overcrowded schools and parks are the downstream results of unchecked commercial development. So again, I think the city should immediately implement a temporary moratorium. It takes four votes on the city council. I don't know if we'll get that given the discussion here, but to then holistically study commercial development rather than just looking at one development at a time and determine what changes might be needed in the general plan to reduce the demand on our housing and our infrastructure. So yes, I agree that a pause so the city council can study and make changes to the general plan regarding commercial development is something we should definitely do.
Sarah?
San Carlos is not a tax-rich city. Only about 10% of our property taxes paid by our residents goes towards funding our city. This presents many challenges to providing high-quality services and improving infrastructure and facilities. It is for these reasons that a strong business environment and the sales tax revenues that are generated by our businesses are incredibly important to our community. Placing a moratorium on new commercial development will not move our city in the right direction. As a commissioner for economic development, I've learned a lot about development projects. If elected, I will take an active role in managing development to make sure that as a city we are making smart and responsible land use decisions. I will drive a hard bargain with developers to make sure strong community benefits are included in projects coming to our town. These benefits could be new roads and sidewalks, or infrastructure improvements for water and sewer lines, or more public parking, or funding for parks, to name just a few. It is the City Council's job to make sure that development fits with the character of our town and helps us achieve our goals as a community. If elected, I will put the needs of our community first. And as a mom, it's important to me that we plan for our future and take an active role in shaping its course. Doing nothing, in my opinion, is not an option.
And Laura.
I get it, right? It seems like we've been here, in the short time we've been here, we went from no development to all of a sudden you can't get downtown and find a parking spot. It's frustrating, absolutely. The issue here, I think, is what does City Council do to affect the development that's happening? And I think what we need to do is we need to be thoughtful about that approach. As I talked about earlier, we have office space going in. I talked to a subject matter expert who works in a neighboring community about the value of a office building that and what it adds to our coffers, and he said not much. We have a hotel that's going in, and while that's, we're going to be talking about the occupancy tax there and the benefit that that will bring us from a revenue perspective, what are they really a part of our community or not, right? San Carlos is a very strong community. So now we have what we call it, we're going to be talking about transient occupancy tax in a few moments. That feels kind of weird to me, right? That's not what San Carlos is about. If we were to put a moratorium in place, all the current projects in place, the last hammer would strike 2 years from now. Not to mention that we would face lawsuits. I haven't heard anybody in my canvassing suggesting to me that they want me to manage lawsuits on behalf of the city. I am all for making sure that people have the rights that they for building what they want to build on their property, but it has to be within the regulations, zones, and codes for the city. And I'm committed to working with you in the complexity of our town, which has pretty much every amenity, save a few, to build the city that we're looking to have. And then we manage the construction when it happens so that you can get down and find parking. How does that sound?
Okay, next question, starting with Ken. What is your vision for the east side, particularly the industrial area between Old County Road and Highway 101? How do you see this area evolving over the next 10 to 20 years?
So let's be forthright about this. The folks in the greater East San Carlos area feel hemmed in on all sides because you've got the trestle apartments and the railroad on the west side, and you've got all the new hotels and commercial buildings on the east side. So they worry about more cut-through traffic, as they should. They're annoyed by the aviation traffic at the airport that is increasingly louder and more frequent with planes and helicopters. And, you know, this is kind of the last bastion of affordability in our town, but even really for those who are lucky enough to have bought in years ago, now it's still pretty much market rate and above market rate, even in that neighborhood. So we need to respect these neighborhoods. They're an important part of our town. They have a right to a life of good living, as the rest of us do. I'm not convinced that widening Holly Street is going to solve our traffic problem. We'll just create another Ralston Avenue with traffic bunched up. We should be redirecting some of that traffic to other exits from the freeway. We really need to take a hard look at the Holly interchange that's being proposed to make sure it doesn't become the debacle that it has in Burlingame. I keep going back there because they do good things and they do bad things, and we should learn by looking up and down the road. So. Definitely, we need to preserve the character of our town. We need to be very selective in allowing these big projects like additional hotels and high-rise office buildings to come in.
John?
So as Ken alluded to, you know, our east side residential area has been systematically overlooked for decades here in our town. And I don't think we can allow that to continue. And for one thing, the city should examine the edges of the residential area to make sure that design standards and zoning are in place so that the transitions to the industrial area or higher density housing are not abrupt. That's a worry I know that our east side residents have, and they're worried about getting squeezed. In the industrial area, we need to support our current businesses, our current small businesses, particularly in what's becoming known as the industrial arts area, which, by the way, Sarah here has been an advocate of. You know, increased lighting and trash receptacles and pickup there are some things we can do now. The danger is, as Ken alluded to, is we're allowing large developers to build massive structures like the new six-story Alexandria Real Estate building on Industrial Road. They're now doubling down by having purchased the L3 property across the street. What that means is the Redwood cityization of our industrial area has begun. Instead of driving out small businesses that was taken over by that large building, we should focus on supporting them, especially the clusters we have in certain areas. Things like outdoor recreation, craft brewing and winemaking, custom home remodeling, and small food manufacturing should be the areas we focus on, not new massive office complexes.
Sarah?
The east side of San Carlos is comprised of neighborhoods and businesses. My friends live in this neighborhood, and our children go to school together. This area is also home to many businesses, where sales tax revenue account for a large portion of our town's revenue. In the next decade, the area between Old County Road and Highway 101 will evolve. Developer Alexandria, as John mentioned, has plans to build a large biotech campus. This development project is an example of an opportunity for our city government to advocate for strong community givebacks. As chair of the Economic Development Advisory Commission last year, I also worked with business owners in the East Side's Industrial Arts District to bring their concerns regarding lighting, sidewalks, and clean and safe streets to the attention of our city government. This is another area that has a lot of potential to evolve and become a destination for more of our residents. As our East Side evolves, we must always be mindful that this community is a neighborhood with children and residential concerns that must be balanced with business opportunities. Residents have shared their concerns with me. Cars speeding along Holly Street, cut through traffic on neighborhood roads, rents increasing on family-owned businesses, and residents feeling like their concerns have not been heard by our decision makers. My vision for our East Side is to engage with our community, residents, and business owners, and openly discuss our future. Our residents should feel involved in the process from the very beginning so we can achieve a vision that benefits everyone in our community.
Laura?
Thank you. I've canvassed and spoken to many residents. And in fact, one of the first people that I spoke to when I started this journey was one of the former leaders of East San Carlos. And he gave me a walking tour of the city, and I gained a greater appreciation for the dynamic, vibrant, and incredible amount of tension that exists over there. As we talked about, there's a train track and an airport on either side, a freeway, and then four of the main entry points into San Carlos, which everybody seems to use. I think we can start with simple things. For example, I think we could do a traffic study. If we take a look at the general plan that was designed a few years ago, they did a traffic study at that point, but it was all hypothetical. Now that we have construction ongoing, I think we need to take another look at it and see and get some real data about how that's being impacted. And then I think we need to talk to all stakeholders across San Carlos to work together to make sure that it's not just all in East San Carlos if we're going to make these changes. We have light industry that is really the backbone of the peninsula. So many skilled workers. I've been endorsed by the San Mateo Labor Council, and I've been informed that many of the talent that helps build our community is housed there. So I'm not in favor of just pushing out an entire community. I think we need to think creatively about what happens over on that side of town, and I'm looking for engagement for the entire community as we move forward, and I want this conversation to continue. These problems are not easy, and they're not simple to solve. Holly Street is certainly still unresolved. When I walked along that street and I talked to the neighbors, I was heartbroken to see so many small shoes on the doorstep. That's not a safe place or a healthy place to raise kids, but it's one of the only affordable places in San Carlos to buy a home. I think we need to really think about how we're treating all of the people who live in our community, and I will be that advocate and open my door and welcome you to my table to have that conversation.
Adam?
So, for me, I think, you know, I see East San Carlos as an evolution under kind of two lenses. It's both a commercial fiscal engine for us and an urban planning opportunity for us. There's the potential for some great change on the commercial side, but I think we also need to look at protecting the Loriola neighborhood that's there. They have been through a lot, and you know, looking at some of the things they're asking for is not a lot. I mean, they want to get some bulbouts on the street so that they don't all become pass-throughs for people trying to cut and not go through East San Carlos Avenue or on Holly. I think we should invest more in Loriola Park. And look at also at the potential of I mentioned earlier about a greenway along the Pulgas Creek over there to have a walking path. And I think it's a great opportunity to add biking over in the East San Carlos side. We've got some great opportunities to create some diversity in that neighborhood and support that neighborhood. At the same time, the the commercial opportunities there are amazing. I think we've got, you know, we've got some growth coming happening there, and we need to work with the developers to make sure we put pressure on them to provide, whether it's daycare centers, whether it's, you know, their own cafeteria. So they are working to get their folks to and from work, but also looking at adding retail and restaurants, making the industrial arts area a more vibrant area that we can clean it up, work with those small businesses there. They are a huge tax generating area for us in terms of sales tax, larger than any other part in the city. And I think there's opportunity. Everyone runs and wants to go to Holly. We have other great commercial areas, Laurel Street, but we have other great commercial areas that we can develop more and become a place that's an attractive place for people to go. We can beautify those areas and work together with the community on both on the commercial side and on the neighborhood side to protect those neighborhoods.
Okay, next question. Starting with John, what is your position on local tax measures NN and QQ?
Thank you. So measure NN is the marijuana tax. And, you know, it really kind of appears to be a way of for us to have our cake and eat it too, meaning the city's hired a consultant to find a way to bring commercial marijuana businesses to town, not retail businesses, but the commercial end. And now we're being asked to be able to increase taxes on them, which of course will discourage them from coming at all. But we don't have any of those businesses here now, and we can use the revenue, as I'll talk about in the next measure. And since we don't currently allow retail stores and this measure won't change that, I'll be voting yes on that measure. In terms of measure QQ, I think it's really the perfect example of the old saying, don't tax you, don't tax me, tax that man behind the tree. You know, it's a business traveler and tourist tax, so it doesn't fall on our residents. And the dirty little secret we have here is that we're going to need the revenue since our pension payments are projected to increase 65% in 5 years. That's a couple million, about $2.5 million. By law, we have to make those pension payments. Everything else can be cut. To avoid those cuts, we'll need more revenue. So if taxing tourists and business travelers keeps us from reducing needed services, I'll take it and I'll be voting yes.
Sarah?
I support both measures NN and QQ. With regard to the cannabis business tax, it is important to remember that retail cannabis sales in San Carlos are not allowed, as John mentioned. Currently, only commercial cannabis cultivation, manufacturing, and testing is allowed. No commercial cannabis businesses are currently operating in our town. If a commercial cannabis business were to open in San Carlos, the transactions would be between businesses where sales tax would not be collected. Therefore, this tax is really a proactive measure to help cover business-to-business transactions and could be an effective source of future revenue. With regard to the transient occupancy tax, San Carlos's current tax charged to hotel travelers has remained unchanged for the last 29 years and is among the lowest in our county. The increase in this tax rate is long overdue. The beauty of this tax is that 100% of the revenue generated stays right here in San Carlos. With one new hotel recently opened and two more slated to open in the next few years, estimates for additional revenue generated could total between $850,000 and $1.6 million per year. This is a significant amount of funding that could be used to improve traffic circulation, increase police services, updating aging roads or parks, and recreational facilities. So I support this measure as well.
And Laura.
So our general fund is $38 million. We have 30,000 people in San Carlos, and that works out to be about $1,300 per resident. Nearly half of the funds go to fire and safety. As was mentioned earlier, we do need revenue sources because there's a lot of work to be done. I think I have 6 pages of to-dos after talking to many of you over the last 24 months. The occupancy tax is an interesting one because if we look at that model, Marriott recently opened, and shortly after they opened, they had a statistic that suggested that their average length of stay was 19 days, and these are corporate expense accounts. So there's no cost, for example, to any resident for us to raise that particular tax unless you plan to go stay there for 19 days. The other one around the cannabis business tax, so Fiona Ma, who's running for state controller, educated me to the fact that part of the challenge with the cannabis is that it's not federally recognized. So these businesses can't open bank accounts. Because it's a cash-based business, that could bring an unsavory element to our community. We hold our safety, our safe community dear to our hearts. And so we would need this additional revenue in order to make sure that we have the services to manage any of these businesses that might arrive here. So I'm in favor of both taxes.
Adam?
Thanks, Dave. So I'm also in favor of both taxes. I think on the cannabis tax, I mean, as Sarah pointed out, we don't have retail. We're not, the city council is not allowing retail at this point, so we're not presupposing that by this tax, but I think it does could generate potentially over $200,000 in tax revenue per year for the city. And it is a business-to-business tax, and it's, I think, an opportunity to generate some revenue, either for public safety or targeted towards benefits for the community. And again, on the transit occupancy tax, I mean, we are one of the lowest in the county. Raising it up to 14% from 10% can generate up to $1.65 million per year for us. We are going to see more hotels likely coming online. And, you know, I'd love to see some of the money from that go into parks, some of it into a reserve fund for us. And a deal, and sort of to pay some things forward if it's on pensions or other areas. But it's a, you know, we're not taxing ourselves. It's taxing business travelers and others coming here. And I think it's a you know, good thing to do.
Ken?
You know, I sat through two city council meetings where the presentations were made by our community development planning department on the glories and the amount of money that we might be getting from having marijuana-based distribution businesses here in town. I never once heard a conversation with the council on whether we really wanted those businesses in town. And, you know, the fact that we're not having retail establishments, I think that's a good thing. If the tax is there merely to be covering ourselves if these businesses should come in, then I don't have a problem with that. But I really think we should have the conversation and have the community weigh in on whether we want to have this kind of business here, whether we think it's worth it for the revenues it might generate. So I'm a sort of tentative yes on allowing for that, but we do need to talk to people more about that. In terms of the transit occupancy tax, again, I go back to my previous digs in Burlingame. Wouldn't you like to have somebody that's been through a lot of these issues before about things? Burlingame's revenue consisted of about one-third on transit occupancy tax from the hotels, another third from retail, largely the auto row dealers that are there, and the remainder from standard property taxes. And yes, I would support a TOT increase. Our neighboring cities are at 12%. Palo Alto is at 14, and San Jose, I believe, is also close to that. Yeah, no, San Jose is at 10%, I'm sorry. Oakland's at 14%, San Francisco at 14%, and I see no reason why we shouldn't increase that tax.
Okay, I'm gonna diverge from the prepared questions to get to the audience questions, as many as we can. In the interest of time, in about 20 minutes, we're gonna get to the closing statements. So I'm gonna ask Tom if you could bring any up that you have. And as I mentioned, any that we don't get to, we'll ask the candidates to respond to you offline directly by email or by phone. First question here, what do you know about the processes of the planning and building departments? Are you aware that additional staff is needed? The time frame for approvals are detrimental to small businesses and homeowners. Start with Sarah.
I am remodeling my house right now, so I feel that person's pain. I understand a lot of our staffing is done by consultants, and that helps the city save money on pension liabilities. I did recently read that I think we have open positions for planners that the city is looking to fill right now, so I am encouraged by that. But I do know that it is a long process, especially if you have to go through the Residential Design Review Committee. And the second part, sorry.
Was, do you realize that the time frame for approvals is detrimental?
Yes, time is money. I understand that too, yes. So I would like to see the city staff up a little more, but it's staffing is something that I would want to study more in detail as a member of City Council. But I do want to really help our community in facilitating that process. I know a lot of us live in older homes and we'd like to do that kitchen remodel or, you know, update our homes. So it's something that I would like to look into as well. Thank you.
Laura, same question.
Yeah, so having had the opportunity to take the Citizens Academy last year, which is a great course, and I recommend it highly. It's an 8-week course, and you get an opportunity to meet with all of the functional departments in San Carlos. That I think, and in combination with serving on Single Family Housing Advisory Committee, one of the barriers is if we have an unclear code. So where we have vagueness, it can slow things down. In addition, I think as being a business person myself and running my own business, what is measured is managed. So every year I start the question, I turn to my other half and I say, okay, what is it I have to do this year? And I know, and I'm really clear about what I have to do. So I think we need to look into and understand what are the processes that are slowing the process down. As we talked about earlier, our resources are precious. $1,300 per resident ladders up to a $38 million a year general fund. So I don't know that we can just run out and hire additional people, but I think we need to really look at our current processes, what's working with them, what's not working with them, so we can and make it faster and easier for people to build the home of their dreams, but within reason, because we learned from Shaq that there's some challenges, right, with the big houses in San Carlos, and also from the business owner perspective, right? So I get it.
Adam, same question.
So I too am remodeling my house. It seemed like a great idea at the time. Run for City Council, remodel your house, do it all at once. Might be a little much to handle, but you know, I agree with Sarah that we need to, and you know, we need to look at. We have an opportunity here with this growth to maybe put some more resources into planning, hire some more planners, maybe expand the hours for people, so maybe it hits lunchtime, so people who are working can access the planning department as well. But I think we need to have a broader conversation around that and understand what's possible and what the opportunities are. And we want to make things easier for people who are, you know, working on their homes and remodeling their homes. It's time is money, and so I'd be open to looking at what potential there is.
Ken?
So my wife and I did a remodeling project about 10 years ago. And I must say, and really provide commendation to the planning department and the building department, very professional, very good people to work with, very understanding in what the needs are of each individual homeowner. That said, they are definitely under-resourced with the flood of building permit applications and remodelings that have happened. In my area in White Oaks, it seems like every fourth house is under construction, and we just don't have the resources to get all these through. We also need to realize that we have to resolve the floor area ratio issue of oversized houses going on small lots. The whole idea here is to find a compromise between what new owners need and want to raise their families and what is a fair situation in a neighborhood, not to be towering above the house next door, which might decrease that house's value as well of its son and other issues. So we need to get that resolved. It's in front of the council, will be very shortly. Whether that resolution takes place before or after the election is anybody's guess, but we shouldn't rush into this, and we should let the whole process play out, listen to everybody, come up with a good plan. That will help the process, the permit process, because then we will have guidelines, whereas right now we have none.
John.
So yeah, it is an issue here in town. I am not remodeling my home, but I need to. So at some point, I'll probably run into it. The city is, in fact, hiring new people. Right now, they're hiring an assistant planner and a full-time planner, and that definitely needs to be done. We can also then look into hiring more consultants, because as now is mentioned, we use consultants now, and that we're going to have to probably use those far into the future, given the volume that we have here. But we are in fact hiring new people right now. You know, to the code issue, just the other night in the Planning Commission, there was discussion about a new home that was being built on Eaton. Turns out that it's not clear in our code what an actual story is. You talk about one or two or three-story building. The code's not really clear on how you actually define stories, and so that's an issue as well. But yes, I agree that we do need to hire more people, and you know, hopefully the issue regarding the Florida Air Reshow and the fact that we do have large homes that are being built, maybe outside of what needs to be in the neighborhood, let's hope that's handled and done before we get on the council, and then somebody else takes care of it. All right, thanks.
Good luck with that.
Okay, next question, starting with Laura. What are the two most important issues for the council to tackle next year?
There we go again, just like in sixth grade when I ran for class president. So really, I mean, it all comes down to this, right? Everybody I talk to, every time I go out and have a coffee or knock on somebody's door, the issue comes up about development in San Carlos, right? And the tension is the fact that we love our community, we love its charm, and we really, really want to preserve that. But there's just a lot of tension around that right now. The economy is going crazy, and all of these projects started at all the same time. In addition to that, we need to just be thoughtful about how we go about doing it. What I'm wondering about is, why are we still trying to have two-way roads when there's a big construction project going on? Maybe we convert one to a one-way street. Just simple things that we can look at. In terms of, you know, traffic and speeding, I've heard from the folks on the St. Francis Street with some of those traffic mitigation, speed and traffic slowdown or calming measures that have taken place are actually working. So I think we need to look at the things that are working, and I think we need to look at the things that are not working and come together as a community and figure out, what do we want for San Carlos and how do we want to be? Some of the small businesses on San Carlos that we love are under incredible stress because their rent may go up four times. And if those rents go up four times, then they're not going to be able to survive. So I think City Council can work with Chamber of Commerce as well as EDAC to do promotion programs and to help those small businesses get the word out about the value that they bring. Many of them offer online purchasing. As well, when we built the parking garage, there was really no notification or tool that was given, for example, to the folks in the small businesses, and they're still suffering from people thinking there's not parking. Simple things that I think we can do to improve our community by working together.
Adam, same question.
And Dave, can you just repeat the question so I have it?
Yeah, the two most important things that the council will face next year.
So I would say when I'm out talking to people, development is the overarching issue, but it's really traffic and parking is what I hear from people now. And I think there's ways that we can help manage some of the development and the growth in a way that's positive for the community. For example, I'd love to make sure we maintain our small community feel. So the 600 to 800 block of Laurel, which is sort of where everyone goes, is currently zoned for 50 feet. You can have four stories. I'd love to see us go and say, we're going to cap it at 30 feet and have it two stories. Now, you can build around that and on El Camino and other areas, but let's keep those couple blocks smaller and keep that small town charm. I also think when we start looking at parking downtown, we may see other developments on El Camino that are either commercial or residential. Let's make sure there's enough extra parking for people coming downtown so that we require the developers to put some of the parking in there. But to me, it's sort of managing that overall development. I know it's a big bucket issue, and I pull it out, it's traffic and parking, and it's in our neighborhoods too. I mean, when I walked on St. Francis and Eaton, the people on St. Francis are happy they have the speed bumps. The people on Eaton are not happy that St. Francis has the speed bumps because now everyone goes to Eaton and speeds. So I talked to one lady who said that car drove into a dumpster that was on her street. So I think we have to think holistically about how we manage some of the traffic in our neighborhoods and more broadly downtown as well.
Ken?
Thank you. You know, I think public safety is the overriding issue. Certainly development is a big thing that with all of us and maintaining the character of our town. But if we're not safe, if we don't have safe streets, if we don't control traffic and speed, if we don't put in traffic signals and stop signs at pedestrian crossings and some of the ones that are very hazardous, for example, in El Camino, then it's going to impact the quality of life. The other thing that we haven't been addressing is one-third of our city up in the Crestview, Devonshire Canyon areas. Do you know that the folks that are living up there, and some of you may be from there, worry every year about the danger of fire? And what's happened is a lot of the areas that were clear-cut years ago as part of funded programs have now been overgrown with additional grass and dying trees. I have put forth on a change.org petition a proposal to put in heat-sensing devices along the hillside, do a trial project to use the PG&E fine money that's come in that will be looked at by a new foundation that will have $2 million to spend. Let's look at protecting a third of our city, the Highlands areas, and making sure that we have every level of fire protection, including more clear cutting, more defensible open space, and some of the new technologies that will help us be a safer place to live.
John?
So I think really the two most important things is we've talked about all night. The first one, of course, is development. And working with our developers to make sure that those projects that we do permit do have the kinds of impact fees and do have the kinds of percentage of affordable housing in them that we really want them to have. And it's a balancing act, there's no question about it. We kind of heard that here earlier, between what's gonna be financially affordable for developers and what isn't. But we need to, again, push them as hard as we can. Secondly, I think, as we've heard as well, is traffic is a big issue, particularly the cut-through traffic, and also for those folks who live on Holly. If you've ever actually walked down Holly Street there, that one block there, it appears to be slow and it's sometimes crowded, which it is, except when the light changes. And then the folks in the front decide that what they want to do is step on the gas to get to the next light, and that is quite a dangerous street there. Particularly for people walking up and down it. I think we need to look at some traffic slowing measures there. Now, obviously, we can't do calming measures like bulbing there, but we can do things like possibly rumble strips or some other things that give people the understanding that they're moving too fast there.
And Sarah.
The two issues that I think that we need to tackle, top priorities. Number one is traffic and infrastructure. Not long after moving to San Carlos, I petitioned the city for a four-way stop in my neighborhood. And if some of you have been through that process, it's long, but it was granted and it's made a big difference in the quality of life for me and my neighbors. I think as a city, we can do a better job thinking about how we can get people safely and effectively through our town. And I'm not just talking about commuters. I'm talking about safe routes to school for our kids who are walking and riding their bikes to school. I'm also talking about helping commuters who ride Caltrain make it the last mile between the train and their homes or the train and their jobs here. So maybe we need protected bike lanes. Maybe we need more shuttle services. These are areas where we can be proactive and think about the big picture. And we've talked about development a lot tonight, and I know that's on the top of minds of a lot of our residents here. And I think that our next city council's job is to really balance development with maintaining our small town charm. I love our downtown. I love lots of our businesses. We try and shop locally here. I think one area that we haven't covered tonight is that San Carlos has room to welcome more family-oriented businesses. Our need for new daycare and after-school facilities is an example of an unmet need in our community. I personally waited in line at 5 a.m. to get my son on a preschool wait list, and that was several years ago. And I know that demand is even greater now. So I think that development in many aspects, not just the big developments, but also thinking about growing businesses in our community is important, and managing traffic.
Thank you. And one last question from the audience, and it came up briefly in one of your responses, and it's asked a couple times here, and this will be our last one before we get to the closing comments, and I would ask the council candidates to answer the other council or questions from the audience offline, as I mentioned earlier, so I will get those to you. The last question from the audience, please explain your understanding of the new recommendations by the Planning Commission for the RS6 zone, the changes in house size for the lot. Does that make sense, starting with Adam?
Sure, can you just read that one more time, David?
Well, it has to do with
the zoning changes that we're talking about for house sizes.
Right.
Sure, got it. So, I mean, there's been a long process. Laura obviously mentioned that she was on the housing, on the SHAC commission, and their planning commission has looked at things as well. And the city council will at some point, and hopefully in the near future, whether it's this current council or the new council, look at this issue. I think it's important that we look at keeping our character of our homes, giving the architects some flexibility around design, but also looking to reduce some of the size of the homes in our community. I think we live in a community that has small lots, and they have to sort of meet those needs. But I think thinking also about, we don't always need two-car garages. We can look at one-car garage. We give some flexibility to people moving forward. But I think it's a good step. I think we need to, move things forward, look at both the Planning Commission's views and the SHAC views, and City Council will have an opportunity to weigh in on that. But for sure, we need to reduce some of the housing sizes and be creative and flexible to some degree.
Ken?
So once again, this was an issue that in my previous residence in Burlingame, we addressed about 25 years ago, as most of the other peninsula cities have, establishing floor area ratios, establishing design review processes. It's never perfect when you have a policy that says the floor area ratio should be 53% of a 4,000 square foot lot or 59% of a 4,000 square foot lot. That's where the issues are pending right now. I think there needs to be certain thresholds that prevent overbuilding from going from one side of the yard to the other and basically creating a shadow for the neighbor. I think there also needs to be flexibility by a design review committee, because design is really very subjective. It's a matter of what strikes your fancy, and whether you hire an expensive architect or an inexpensive architect designer, a lot of the quality of what the property looks like is based on the design concept, not just the floor area ratio. But I think we need to get both of those in alignment, and we need to have policies that are equivalent to what other cities north and south of us have and have had for 20 years. It's time for us to get on board.
John?
Yeah, so I think that the important thing here, I think we was asked about what the Planning Commission is expected to put forward to the City Council. And my understanding is it's going to be a floor area ratio, as we talked about, of 0.5, I believe, is what's being put forward. Seems to me that is something that we, like Ken was saying, that we should work for. I would be supportive of that. We have now, I believe, we have small lots, as we said earlier. We have small lots here in town, and for most of our town, and we have houses that have grown quite large. And again, they've shadowed other houses. They've been close to neighbors, and it's really compacting our town. So I would be in favor of smaller units, again, with what the Planning Commission is putting forward.
Sarah?
Our community has undergone a two-year effort to mitigate the impact of oversized homes in San Carlos on our residents and our neighborhoods. I've been knocking on doors over the last several weeks and understand that this is a top concern for many in our community. I also sat in on the Planning Commission meeting several weeks ago to learn more about this process and the ideas being spoken about. And I know that the current focus is on floor area ratio and lot coverage. I appreciate the fact that so many concerned citizens, including Good Growth San Carlos, have voiced their opinions and provided input into the policymaking process. And I also support the process of examining standards in place in our peer cities to see what we could align with standards already in the peninsula. This issue will be discussed at upcoming City Council meetings. My understanding is on the 8th and the 22nd. I would encourage everyone who is interested in this process to please attend or to write your City Council member so that your voice is heard. I look forward to following the process more.
Laura.
Yeah, thank you. So as I mentioned, I've served on the Single Family Housing Advisory Committee, and the issue really is around two things. One is allowing a homeowner to build the home of their dreams, but making sure that their neighbor has privacy and sunlight and safety. The challenge that we have with the current code is that it's too vague. When we purchased our home, the one next door was torn down and a new home was being built. And I kept looking up and up and up, and I kept looking down the lot and down the lot, and it was ginormous. So our neighbors were very concerned, and our house was elected the leader of the pack. So we expressed our concerns to the review committee, and we knew we were in trouble when one of the reviewers said, "I'm so impressed that the architect got all of that house on that tiny lot." So here we are, as Sarah mentioned, 2 years later, and my understanding is that many of the recommendations that were forwarded by the Shack Committee have evolved over time through the public comment period. Staff has informed me that the current recommendations, they don't believe or they can't verify, will address the bulk and mass issues. So I would like us to ask, how did we go from trying to put together a thoughtful process and give people some guidelines that are clear and crisp that everybody can understand, to now going back to what might feel like the same thing? I'm not sure that that's exactly where we are, because I'm trying to study the data that came out of Planning Commission last week. But I think we need to ask ourselves whether or not the objectives were met. And that's all, right? Well, everybody wants what they want when they want it, but we have to work together as a community, and sometimes we have to make hard choices.
Okay, thank you. If I can go one more, there we go. Okay, as we approach the end of the forum this evening, we'll allow each candidate 2 minutes for closing remarks. In these remarks, I will ask the candidates to address two questions. What makes you uniquely qualified to represent San Carlos on the City Council? And what message do you want to leave with those who are here this evening and watching at home? And we'll start with Adam and work from right to left this time.
Get to go first this time. That's good. So you can take a look around San Carlos right now and think the glass is half empty. It's tough to get through traffic, only to find your path blocked by a construction truck. Finding parking is often impossible. Rents are skyrocketing, and that's having an effect on all our employers, from restaurants to daycare providers to healthcare workers. Yes, we have challenges, but we have also great possibilities. Let's see this growth as a period of unparalleled prosperity. Unemployment is at an all-time low. Growth in tax revenue will drive opportunities that improve the overall quality of life for San Carlos. That means investing in recreation for all ages, like upgrading parks and adding bike lanes. We can address mobility challenges to get seniors and others around town more easily. We can create more pedestrian-friendly streets with additional sidewalks, especially around schools. We could add affordable housing for our teachers so they can stay in our community. South Laurel and the commercial areas of East San Carlos have the opportunity to extend our charming downtown quarter to more restaurants and retail. And let's be clear, we should also increase our reserves so that we're prepared for the next economic slowdown to ensure that we can maintain the quality of life for our residents. There are complex, serious issues facing our community. They need immediate attention, and I can start on day one. I have a network of strong relationships with local business leaders, police and fire, nonprofit organizations, and deep connections into our school leadership. Some of these problems we face are bigger than just what San Carlos can handle. And I know how to work with county and state elected officials to move quickly to serve our interests. And finally, I have deep experience working on public policy to come up with creative solutions to our challenge. I'm the only one running for City Council with elected experience and have delivered results. I'll hit the ground running because I have the governmental experience, the commitment to San Carlos, and the character to solve these problems so that San Carlos emerges on stronger financial footing, retains its small town character, and provides a better quality of life for our residents. I'm asking for your vote and would be honored to serve on our City Council.
So as I mentioned at the top of our conversation, I'm a working mom of two amazing young men. I'm a small business owner, and I have the good fortune to employ San Carlins. There's incredible talent here, as I'm sure you all know, and many of you are that. When we arrived here, I began participating right away. I was a little league coach. One of my first tasks was to manage the dugout, and I'm pretty sure if I can manage a dugout, I can manage the dais. When I decided to run for City Council, at that moment in time, I decided that the job started then. I didn't want to wait until I was elected, and I, of course, hope I have your vote. But for example, the childcare issue, Smarty is an after-school program at the elementary schools that was cut, capacity was cut this year. So I immediately started trying to source, through the encouragement of a friend who has small children, other alternatives. So I called the corporate childcare groups. I called the businesses in San Carlos that already have a business here. They weren't interested. I looked at our Parks and Rec program, and I saw that they already have Up program. So I've met with Amy and Jeff Maltby, and I've asked them to please get the word out about that, as well as let's get feedback and make sure that if we're not at capacity, why are we not at capacity? A few days before Hometown Days, I was walking down Laurel Street, and there was trash and litter all over, and the sidewalk was sticky from the sick trees. So I got out my handy Inform San Carlos app, and I was a mayor for a moment, and I took a photograph of the debris, and I sent that into City Hall, and I said, please clean the streets, because we have a big party this weekend, and I don't want our neighbors to think that we don't know how to clean our house. I will take this responsibility seriously. I will be one of five votes, but when I make a vote, it's for 30,000 people. And I don't take that lightly. I will create avenues and new channels of communication so that big issues that are going to face our community won't blindside you, that you will have a voice and an opportunity to express your needs and concerns. We can create town calls. So if you don't want to drive downtown, we can open up a conference line, we can have a conversation, and we can do those at different times of day to make it convenient. I really, really want your vote, your support. I want this job. I've never worked harder for a job in my life. And I love this community, and I want to retire here. Thank you.
I'm running for City Council because I want to put my background in public policy and government to work for San Carlos. If elected, I will continue to be a strong advocate for our community. I will take a proactive approach to ensure public safety resources are protected, development projects include benefits that positively impact San Carlos, and parking and traffic concerns are addressed. I will also focus on repairing our roads, expanding our bike lanes and safe routes to school, and updating our aging park facilities. I will actively solicit public feedback, and I will work hard to ensure that as our community grows, the characteristics that make San Carlos so unique are preserved. I find public service to be deeply rewarding. That's why I've dedicated so much time as a volunteer in our community over the last 8 years, and that's why I'm ready to take on a new role on City Council. It is not lost on me that as an elected official, I would be accountable to our community. I will work hard to ensure the concerns of our community are reflected in the work done by our City Council. We have more issues to tackle going forward that were not even discussed tonight. Important issues like funding for our police and fire departments, meeting our unfunded pension liability obligations, updating our daycare regulations and zoning, proactively addressing climate change and sea level rise, working with the San Carlos School District to tackle issues that are important to the schools and the city, and maintaining a balanced budget and a healthy rainy day fund that can be tapped during times of economic downturn. My years of service in San Carlos have taught me a lot about the values our community holds dear and the challenges that we must address ahead. As a mother raising my two children here, I want San Carlos to be a town that they enjoy coming home to and where they have a chance to raise their families one day if they so choose. I have the qualifications, skills, and history of service to be an effective council member, and I would love to earn your vote in November. Thank you for the opportunity to speak with you tonight.
So again, I want to thank Dave and the Chamber of Commerce and the city and all my fellow candidates here on the panel, and especially the residents of San Carlos, those in the room and those watching on TV, for being part of this debate. You know, I think it showcases just how much we all care about our city and our future. You know, there's no doubt that every candidate on this stage cares about the future and how to make it the best it can be. You've heard us agree on some things and disagree on others, but I hope you recognize how we all want to work together and will work together on behalf of everyone who lives here. And speaking of lives here, I grew up here. And so I've seen the changes in San Carlos from when it was a very small town when I first moved here and when I started going through Britton Acres and Terrellwood and San Carlos High to what it is now. But in the meantime, I moved to some other places, and there I was able to gain some experience that would be useful here. I worked on Capitol Hill in Washington, D.C., just like Adam did. And I worked in the federal government at the same exact time that Sarah did in Washington, D.C. I worked in state government in the state of Georgia, and when I was in Washington, D.C., I was in the city government there as well on commissions appointed by the mayor. So I've got the kinds of experience and the kinds of background that can allow me to make, I hope, the right decisions for this town. But the way to make those right decisions is to listen to everyone in the city, not just a few, but everyone. And that's what I pledge to do. You know, tonight we focused on development in all its forms, And while some development is natural and inevitable, some is mandated by the state, what is clear is we have the ability to slow and shape that development, and particularly commercial development, so we don't overwhelm our resources and keep the character of the town we love. We can ensure a safe town for our children and our families. We can make sure we're a town that supports our seniors with programs to age in place, and that we remain a walkable and friendly town. Again, like I said earlier, where an evening stroll on Laurel means running to neighbors and friends. I ask you to join me in keeping the character of San Carlos, and I ask for your vote in November. Thanks.
Thanks, everyone, for attending tonight. Happy to make the final concluding remarks. Let me point out that the success that I've had in multiple careers has been in carefully evaluating each policy and proposal without regard to special interests or ideology. You know, I was a newspaper reporter and editor for 25 years. I asked the hard questions. I made public officials accountable. I exposed corruption and malfeasance in government. I know something about the inside corridors of government and the right questions to ask, and it's important to ask those questions. I seek a collaboration with like-minded partners and always believe that elected officials should lead by example. Talk is cheap, but action is what moves us forward. We need a vision. We need to engage stakeholders both inside and outside of San Carlos if we're going to preserve the motto of the City of Good Living. This takes some creativity, but I believe the residents here represent some of the most creative problem solvers in the Bay Area. These include the volunteers that sit on our various commissions. It's my goal that the public should have full access to these groups. They should be meeting at evening hours and in the city council chambers so that more residents could attend and provide comments. Do you know that EDAC, and how many people have ever been to an EDAC meeting, meets on a weekday at 4 p.m. in this little boardroom over here? And I walked into the meeting last week, and they looked at me as if they'd never seen a member of the public come in. That's not transparency. That's not reaching out to the public. That meeting should be in the evening so that working class people can come and attend the meetings. It shouldn't be just some little private consultation for the city manager and his staff. Now, in that vein, I have a few underlying principles. One is that we should always strive to cut through the chase and make policy with common sense. We should always strive to keep our residents in the loop and communicated with when issues come up that affect their neighborhoods. And third, it's my view that every resident and business person should be treated with respect and accorded due process. You know, I consider myself to be an independent thinker. I've always embraced the concept of getting the facts and hearing all sides before reaching a conclusion. Now I'm asking voters to elect a problem solver who can help move us into the future while retaining our heritage as a friendly, welcoming city. Thank you.
Okay, thank you all. I'd like to conclude this evening by thanking all of you for being here, for submitting your questions, and we'll get those answers to your questions if we didn't get to them. I'd also like to thank three of the Chamber's board members who are here this evening, Julie Schneider, Jason Mansfield, and Tom Davids. And finally, I'd like to thank and congratulate all of you for running for City Council and wish you all the best over the next month as you campaign toward the final goal. And I want to remind everyone to vote on November 6th and to tell all of your friends between now and November 6th, this forum will be televised, rebroadcast on Comcast Channel 27 and AT&T U-verse Channel 99 daily. Mondays through Wednesdays at 7 p.m. and Thursdays through Sundays at 10 a.m. And it'll also be streamed online, so you'll be able to access that at any time. So there's plenty of opportunities for others to take advantage of what we've heard all here this evening. And I want to thank again everyone, and I'm going to conclude by saying have a great evening and remember to vote.